Good morning and welcome. What a better way to start. Christmas Sunday. I just want to remind you of a couple things we've got coming up here and next week as New Year's comes. On Saturday, New Year's Eve, we're going to gather at 6:30 here and just have a time of food and fellowship and prayer and games. So if you'd like to come and join us, please do and bring your favorite food to share. And then on Sunday evening, we're just having one church service next Sunday also at 10:30. So Sunday evening, we're going to go bowling together. If you'd like to join us there, we're going to Strike Zone. It's $10 a person, and that's for food and bowling and all that. You're all invited to come and join us for that. We just want to have a time of fellowship as often as we can, because God says when we're together, He's with us. So we just ask that you would just worship with us as we sing together and praise the Lord today.
Everywhere, go tell it on the mountain that Jesus. Would you please stand with me today as we read from the Word? In Luke chapter 1, verses 50 through 53, it says, "His mercy extends to those who fear him, his generation from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones. He has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but he has sent the rich away empty."
Messiah. Let us pray. Father, as we come to you this morning, Father, we rejoice in the presence. Father, as we reflect on this wonderful day, we can't praise you enough for what all of you've done for us, Father. And Father, for the love that you have for each and every one of us. For Father, you sent your Son. And Father, you sent him to this earth, Lord, that he may live a life without sin as an example, Father, for us. And Father, through his suffering and through his death, and through his defeat of death, Father, and his raise again, Father, we can stand and proclaim you Lord of all. And we thank you, Father, for your gift. We thank you for the peace that comes along with that gift, Father. I ask this morning that you help us. Help us with our hearts and our minds, Lord, to understand what the Christmas peace is all about. You see, Father, for this time of year can be quite hectic for each one of us. May we not forget, Father, that you're on the throne, that you make no mistakes, and Father, that you love us. Father, we pray together for all of our loved ones that are sick. For those who weren't able to be with us this morning, Father, we lift them up to you. And Father, we ask you to touch them. May you be with them, Lord, and comfort them in this time. Be with the families and those who are caring for each one of them, Lord. Give them the strength, the understanding, the endurance, Lord, to carry on and to continue to love, to show your love. And Father, we welcome you this morning to this place. As we're gathered here, Lord, with humbled hearts, Father, rejoicing on this blessed Christmas morn. We just can't praise you enough, Father, for just how wonderful, how great, how merciful you are to us, yet even a sinner. Father, be with us in this service. Be with the songs and the word, Lord, and may you just penetrate our hearts this morning, Lord. May we walk out of here anew, Father, strengthened, with a heart fixed on you and a mind ready to serve. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
If our ushers could come forward. Mike Shank, would you pray for the offering?
ever bright morning star. Lily of the valley, provider and friend. He was yesterday, he'll be tomorrow, the beginning and end. But the angel called him Jesus, born of a virgin. Mary called him
Messiah,
mighty God and King,
bread of life,
is the lasting word
of love that I see.
Light in darkness,
door to heaven,
my home in the sky,
the fountain of living water that never shall run dry. But the angel called him Jesus, born of
It was foretold. In the book of Isaiah, it talks about the Messiah that's coming. And today we celebrate his birth. It's a great time of year. As Mary received the news, she wrote those words, or she said those words that Trey read. And I want to read to you from the message, because I just love sometimes just reading the message. His mercy flows in wave after wave. It's like going to the ocean. It never ends. When one wave stops, there's more coming. Amen. On those who are in awe before him, he bared his arm and showed his strength, scattered the bluffing braggarts. He knocked tyrants off their high horses. He pulled victims up out of the mud. The starving poor sat down at a banquet. Amen. The callous were left out in the cold. Mary had received word. How great it was. And she realized it. I want you to go back with me, if you would, 2,000 years ago. Is in the springtime, here was this young woman.
She was like so many other girls of the day. She was probably helping her mother tend to the chores of the house. She may even be the one who was sent out every morning to the well to gather water for the family for the day. We hear how that happens later on as Jesus met the woman at the well. It was a daily routine. Maybe if she had younger brothers or sisters, she helped out in taking care of them. She had already been pledged in marriage, like most other girls at that age. She was probably excited, as some of you women, and hopefully most of your women, can remember when that time was in your life and you were excited. And as Pastor Bauer would say, if you weren't, keep looking up here. But she was excited. She never thought of herself as any different than any other girl. She didn't live in a family that was very wealthy. And by all indication, she didn't treat anyone else mean. She was somebody that everybody liked. But she was born just like all the other girls of Nazareth. She had been raised up in a manner that she knew the God of her ancestors, of Abraham and Isaac and Moses, the God who had delivered her ancestors out of Egypt from the slavery that they were in, the same God whose heart her great-great, and if you go back 40 generations, grandfather, the King David, had also sought. A God that she served, and yet she didn't know what her special call was. She was just living a normal life. To look around in the city, some might know Mary and some might not. She'd probably hang out with her friends and had fun, just like teenage girls would do. And then one night, the angel Gabriel came to her to give her some information. Information on the mission that God had for her life. That very night, Mary was invited to be a part of God's plan. It wasn't anything new for God. God had already been at work on Mary's behalf. But this news was going to totally change her life. But as we read in Jeremiah, it was news that was already decided long before she was ever formed in the womb. Just as God has plans for each and every one of us, He knew us and He knew His plans for us before we were ever formed in the womb. As we begin to look at Mary's life, we can see some distinct details. First off, God does not make choices because of our stature or our lack thereof of stature. Here was a girl who was poor by all daily standards, yet she was a descendant of royalty because God can use the rich or the poor. That's not important. That's not significant to God's plan. You see, when God wants to use you, He wants to use you right where you are. We hear the story of Mother Teresa, how she spent her entire life in poverty with the poor of Calcutta. She wasn't one who sought fame, but it tended to come to her. But she allowed that fame to be used to glorify God. She once described herself in these ways, as a little pencil in the hand of God who was sending a love letter to the world. Imagine if you would live your life that way, that you're just allowing yourself to be a pencil in the hand of God as He wants to write a love letter. It wasn't because of who she was. It was because she was willing and because God wanted to use her. God can use fame and fortune, but He can use those without it. God doesn't need the rich and fame that the world seeks, because the scriptures tell us God owns 1,000 hills and the cattle on all those hills. God, who created it all, why would He need the riches of the world's standards? You see, God can use us no matter who we are. And when we allow ourselves, we allow God to be at work in our lives, we're going to be changed. Abraham was a man who was from a family of great means. Abraham had some money. He had some servants. He had a lot of livestock. He wasn't poor by any means. His father was the chief officer to the king. But Abraham grew up in a house that worshipped idols. He was taught by his father to worship the sun and the moon. But he began to realize it's not the sun or moon, it's the creator of the sun and moon that I need to be worshiping. And as he was growing up, his great elder Noah was still alive, and he could go and talk to Noah and find out about the flood firsthand. And he could find about how God delivered him and the rainbow of, and the promise that God made in the covenant. And he began to realize that what his father was teaching him was wrong. How he was raised was not correct. And then when he fully allowed God to be in control and to give him the plan that he had for Abraham's life, Abraham became the father of a great nation. And later on, we hear of Moses, who was raised in the palace as a prince, but at some point realized he wasn't Egyptian, he was Hebrew. And he went out and lived on the side of the mountain in somewhat poverty compared to what he was used to as a shepherd. But then he had an encounter with God. And when he became the follower of God and allowed God to work in his life, he became the deliverer who brought an entire nation out of slavery, led by God. And later on, we read of Joseph, or actually earlier, we read of Joseph, who was the youngest son, but he was a jerk, honestly. If you had a younger brother like that, wouldn't you want to throw him in a pit too? Younger kids are always picked on. Sometimes they're the angels, but sometimes they're not. I was the youngest one. I was the angel. But he was sold into slavery, and he was sent off into a foreign land. But eventually God got a hold of him, and he brought him out of what he was in to the point where he was second only to the Pharaoh himself. And when he allowed God to speak to him and give him visions and guide his life, he saved an entire nation, the nation of his family. But it's not just the famous that God works with. You see, sometimes we get caught up and we see people who are famous and we think, well, God's too great for me. Mary never expected to receive any special treatment from God. She didn't expect to see an angel that night. As we read, she was shocked. She was scared, because when you saw an angel, usually you didn't survive that. But the event, that the words that the angel told her, it came as a shock to her. She even asked, how can this be? I don't understand. She'd never bragged anybody that night. She'd never been boastful. And after that night, and she received the news from the angel that she was highly favored, she was still a humble girl who never went out and bragged to everybody. Angel talked to me. Did he talk to you? See, she accepted the call that God had for her life. She didn't understand, but she accepted. And her life was totally changed forever. You see, each one of these people that we read about in the Bible, and we hear about today, is God still at work? It amazes me, as I was looking at Bible college, as I read one that said the miracles of God don't occur anymore. They stopped when the Bible was written. And I'm like, threw that one away. I've got to believe in a miracle, because I've experienced a few in the last couple years. But Mary was one of the greatest examples of when we surrender to God's will. He immediately began to be at work in her. For her, immediately, she was carrying the Messiah, the one who had been foretold in all the scriptures. Thousands of prophecies were going to come true. It was the plan from the beginning of time. just as God has a plan for each and every one of us that he's had in place from the very beginning. Mary accepted God's call upon her life. In Luke 1:38 it says, I am the Lord's servant. May your word to me be fulfilled. See, that's what God wants is a willing heart. She surrendered completely. And she referred to herself as a servant of God. She yielded completely. Her dreams and her plans for her life, she yielded them to God. Her body, her entire life, she yielded to God. And then she celebrated. As we hear Mary's song. When God invited her to be a part, her words were just those of acceptance. In Mary's words, she said that God's mercy is for all who fear him. You see, when we determine that we'll serve God, his work begins in us. But it can't be started until we have given God permission to be at work. Mary's words explain our life if we surrender. We'll witness mighty deeds. We'll be lifted up while the mighty will stumble. Our hunger for God will allow us to see great things. We'll see the impossible happen because when God is at work and God is in control and we are serving God, we become the possible that God uses for the impossible. So often we put Mary up on a pedestal, even to the point of worshiping her and not the Son of God, the one that she bore. She's not to be worshiped. We can praise her for what she did, but she's an example for us. You see, Mary's basically no different than any one of us ever are. God had a plan for her life, and he has a plan for our life too. God blessed her with a wonderful opportunity. And he'll do that for us. God sent a messenger to tell her of the plan that he had for her. And God will send his Holy Spirit to speak to us too. That night, that very night, Mary said yes. Yes to God's plan for her life forever. And now it's up to us to do likewise. She didn't understand it. And we may not understand it. God just wants us to accept it. He's already at work. I love the thought, and I'll never forget that God's already at work until tomorrow before we ever get there. You see, on that first Christmas morning, the God of that first Christmas morning, the God of a future and past and eternity, the God who created everything, who came to earth to save all of mankind, the sins that we commit, that he came to save, that very God has a plan for each and every one of you. It's not because of who we are. God can use every one of us. He just wants us to be the pencil that he can write the love letter with. A plan that's going to totally change our lives. Just like that night when Mary accepted those words given to her by the angel. It wasn't because of the person. It was because of the willingness of the person. And God is ready to send his mercy wave after wave after wave to those who love him. Because he loves you just as much as he loved Mary. Our children are going to perform, and then after that we're going to sing a song in closing. So if Jamie, if you would have the children come on up.
Lights, please. And there were in the same country shepherds, abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them. And they were sore afraid, and the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God, and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. That's what Christmas is all about, Charlie Brown.
Shepherds came to see the baby, stood by his mother's side. Here lay the Savior inside a manger. Oh, what a glorious night! Oh, what a glorious night! I hear the angels sing.
We'd just like to invite you to stand and sing with us as we close out service today. Thank you for who you are. We thank you for the love, Lord, that you had for us. As we really think of that first Christmas, it was for each and every one of us. You come to seek us, to call upon us. Lord, you had a plan for our lives that you still do today. I pray, Lord, that you would give us the insight and wisdom, just as you did with Mary. Watch over us now, God, as we go our separate ways. Strengthen us, call upon us, lead us, guide us. Lord, we ask in your name, amen. You are dismissed.